bei Twitter.
Jetzt,
Twitter in the morning. Use the hashtag C3T or write us an email to hello@c3tradio.org.
Er ist Laserphysiker, was ziemlich großartig klingt.
Er ist ein Laserphysicist. Er
ist ein Science Slammer. Dinge im Leben. Und es, obwohl es ein sehr großes Bild ist, es ist nicht.
Even though it's a very big picture, it's just it's about Tarot-Vision, Microsoft. It's about picture, how you get them and how they're related to each other and how our image is.
Genau, und eine große Runde Applaus und los geht's.
Dankeschön.
Thank you very much.
Ja, schönen guten Morgen.
Good morning, everyone.
Fangen wir direkt mal an.
Just let's get started.
First about me.
Why am I standing here?
Ich bin Physiker,
der
in die Biochemie gewechselt ist, um ein Mikroskop zu bauen. Das habe ich neulich mal einer Comiczeichnerin erzählt und
das hat eine halbe Stunde gedauert, was ich jetzt gerade in einem
Und dabei ist dieses Bild entstanden.
She drew a picture.
Das ist eine ganz, ganz tolle Künstlerin, folgt ihr auf
She's
Twitter
a very good,
und ich bedanke mich nochmal recht herzlich für dieses großartige Bild,
and
was
I want to thank you again for this
Ja, also ich habe in der Physik angefangen und habe dann irgendwie meinen Weg in die Biochemie gefunden, angefangen Mikroskope zu bauen.
And started building microscopes.
Der Talk heißt, es geht um die kleinen Dinge.
Name is about the four things
in life. Und jetzt gucken wir uns erstmal an, welche kleinen Dinge ich meine.
So let's first have a look at the four things which I'm talking about.
Here you can see a one cent piece. Und da kann man so erkennen, da habe ich ein kleines Stück Glas draufgelegt, ein Deckgläschen auf den Zähnen angebracht.
Glass on it. There are some cells on it.
Das können wir so noch nicht erkennen, einfach so mit einer
Kamera.
Da müssen wir schon unser erstes Mikroskop hernehmen.
We have to use our first microscope for this.
And
that's a phase contrast microscope.
Da sieht das erste Bild so aus.
That looks like that.
Auf
you
der
see
Seite
a little bit on the right-hand side, there are some
links
little structures. On the left-hand side, you can see
so
the shapes from the sand piece.
Wenn ich da jetzt
so
weiter
a feeling for the size. If I zoom in to 20, you can see a little bit more of the cells.
At
40, you can see.
Die Kerne erkennen
you see the
und auch
course
ein
bisschen
was von der Zellperipherie.
Also the cell periphery.
Wenn man mehr Details erkennen möchte,
if you want to see more of
dann kann
details,
man nicht mehr Phasenkontrastmikroskopie machen,
face,
dann muss man Fluoreszenz machen.
You have to use fluorescence microscope. So you color and you put light on it and you register this light and then you can see the structures in the cell. So you still use the 40 times magnification as we used here and change to fluorescence.
Und da fängt es dann irgendwie an, wirklich schöne Bilder zu liefern.
You can see we get very beautiful images you can see here.
Sehr, sehr
and that's why I really love the field of microscopy.
So eine Zelle noch mal ein Stück weiter
if we zoom in one of these cells on the left hand side you see the whole picture on the right hand side. It's just the part of the cell.
Kann man irgendwie sehen, ja, okay, da ist eine Menge los.
There you see there are a lot of things in there, and if you zoom in even more,
so weit, dass ich wirklich nur interne Zellstrukturen mir
so you want to see really the internal structures of the cell. And then you can see
Spaghetti.
It gets blurry. It looks like blurred spaghetti.
Bevor ich erkläre, warum die verschwommen sind,
so before I tell you why
this
is happening, so
das,
what are those kind of
cells?
What you can see there, these are microtubuli. That's a very important
also
of, part of the cytoskeleton. Skeleton of the cell, so they can keep its shape. It's formed from proteins, which form such rings, fold from certain parts, which form like a staircase. The diameter is 25 nanometers.
Jetzt kann man allerdings auf so einem Mikroskopiebild, was auf der rechten
on such
Seite
of these microscopy pictures, you can see
25 nanometer sind die
25 nanometers, they don't appear to say. So if you look at the scale bar on the top right corner, this doesn't fit.
These
tubes are way bigger, and that's not, that's not because of magnification, but here, physics is the key reason here. Damn physics! Some of you have already heard about the fraction limits,
and
Abbe has come up with this
in aber viel wichtiger für die
the most important part for fluorescence is
der junge Mann da oben.
This person
ist,
over here,
Baron Rayleigh.
That's Rayleigh.
Baron Rayleigh? Ja, ich glaube schon. Er hat auf jeden Fall sich das Rayleigh-Kriterium ausgedacht. Und
he came up with the Rayleigh-Kriterium, and this criterium tells you how can you, if you have two point-shaped sources, how, when can you still diffract them?
So, for fluorescence microscopy,
all these dyes we use, which gave us these very nice pictures, are just circles form sources.
This
250 nanometers. If you go smaller, you can't tell them apart anymore.
Auf jeden Fall nicht mit normaler Fluoreszenzmikroskopie.
At least not with normal microscopy.
Man kann diese Beugungsgrenze jetzt allerdings ein bisschen
austricksen.
You can't go around the diffraction limit. There are various points. But you have other problems if you use these other techniques.
I have a few.
The first is structured lighting, structured illumination,
SIM. Stimulated emission, depletion,
and the last one is
single molecule localization. 2014
for STET, the Nobel Prize was awarded in chemistry.
Was dahinter steckt, wie die Beugungsgrenze austricksen.
How you use the techniques to go around this diffraction. For SIM, you use Fourier transformations. STET goes into laser technology. So you directly use the light you're going to use. And the last one, STORM, you use a fitting of signals.
STET is a completely
interesting technique.
Ein bisschen langweilig für unseren Kontext
hier. In this context
SIM
here.
Und die Lokalisationsmikroskopie braucht sehr viel Rechenleistung und gute Programme, die dahinter
calculations
stecken.
And lots of programs, and that's what I would like to talk about today.
Mit SIM an.
I'd like to start about SIM.
Die strukturierte Beleuchtung funktioniert SIM works like following. Basierend auf den Moyer-Pattern.
We use the Moyer-Pattern effect.
Da links kann man sehen, wenn man
on the left-hand side, you have two grids. If you move them to respect to each other, there are funny structures. You maybe notice when you go on an autobahn with the car, and you see how this pattern also happened on bridges. On the right-hand side, you can't see much. So start shaking your hand.
Kann man da was erkennen?
Do you see something?
Ich hoffe schon, ich habe oben noch was Kleines. Man sollte einen Menschen in einem roten Hoodie
sehen. You should see a person in a red hoodie.
Das basiert auch auf diesem Moyer-Effekt.
This also is based on this Moyer fringes effect. If you don't shake your head, or just don't you see it?
Sehr schön.
Okay, someone does see it.
Okay. Das hat also funktioniert. Also
so it works. So using this Moyer fringes, you can see something. And that's why we're using in microscopy. Use a grid.
Beleuchten damit
and we illuminate it.
Also wir projizieren ein Gitter mit
we project this grid
in unsere Probe rein,
into our sample
verschieben dieses
and shift it,
drehen es um 60 Grad,
turn it around and shift it again,
drehen es wieder
try
um 60
it, turn it again 30 degrees.
Machen wir
and that's how you make this Fourier transformation from this raw data. And that's how they look like. And if you put them all on top of each other, you get this flower-like shape. Fourier transformation, what? That's just a transformation from the image to the frequency space. So on the outside, you have the small frequencies, small differences, and as center, you have the big differences. So what you get out of it are these funny shapes in the circle. Circle in hand, that's like a normal microscopy picture. But SIM, these rotations, etc., it allows us to get more information from the corner parts. And using this technology, you can get such a picture. And you can see here, we have much more information in one of these images.
Ein paar Mal hin und her geschoben
just because we have rotated and shifted, so we have taken several pictures.
Jetzt habe ich da noch ein, ah ja genau, wie es funktioniert. Wir nehmen
how does it work? We take the raw data,
these
shifts and rotations,
and
put it into a software. For example, here,
FairSIM.
FairSIM is an open source software. If you want to, just look at GitHub and have a look at it. And someone I've studied with at the University of Bielefeld.
Keine Reaktion.
No reaction.
Ist ja noch früh.
It's early in the morning.
Die haben eine freie Software geschrieben und es gibt für
they wrote a software and for SIM
nur Software von Mikroskopie her.
Usually there are only the softwares from these microscope developers
und dann ist es eine black
box. And then it's just a black box.
Die haben jetzt sich das mal vorgeknöpft und eine offene Software daraus gemacht.
Wanted to start a free software, open source software.
Demnächst, im Februar, glaube
and in February there will be the next paper about it, which will be also an open access paper, where they start calculation on GPUs.
Software schlagen.
That will beat every commercial software there.
Und zwar
and commercial software needs 2 minutes for one image, and this one 30 milliseconds.
Das, genau.
And that's, yeah, right. And the nice thing about this technology is you can use the raw data, and perhaps someone thinks, oh, we could do it even better. Maybe this grid isn't perfect sign, and we use another one, and we have different software, and we can put it into another software, and then our picture will get even better. The raw data is just fantastic, and if you take away something from this talk, then raw data is great. And so I have another picture here. It's a SIM image. This is a localization microscopy from liver cells. And it was found that in diagnostics, so in the applications where it has to be fast, there was really an advantage from super resolution for certain diseases, because the pores in the liver cells have the perfect size to use super resolution microscopy, where otherwise tedious lab work would be necessary. This is from Open Access, from a paper in Open Access. You can look at it online. Please do that. And this is from my dear colleague, Viola Mönkemöller. And now we go to localization microscopy. That was my PhD thesis. And the technology is called direct stochastic optical reconstruction, or D-Storm for short. And this is about blinking. We put chemicals and dyes on it with the chemistry, and the dyes don't want to do that anymore, and one out of 2,000 is working, and the others are off. And if you look at that in a microscope, that's what it looks like. In the beginning, I turn on the laser, and then I really need a laser for that, and then by and by they all turn off, and then they start flashing, and these signals are really signals from the individual molecules. They are point-sized, and if I record these signals, 10 or 20,000 pictures as raw data, and then from such a blurred picture, we can get this one. If I put it into the right software, it's called RapidStorm or ThunderStorm, very creative naming. Also free software, you can download it. Just Google for localization software, ThunderStorm and localization software. And with ThunderStorm alone, you get different results. But you can, if you reconstruct it, like here, you can see that, aha, it's not just one microtubule, but there are two. And if you can really distinguish the two, and which made the biologist in me very happy. And it's very clear that this is just an improvement in resolution. And how it works, thank you to Ricardo Henriquez, who made this video. If you can see, if you record the blinking of the Eiffel Tower, then at first you search for the signals, and the same way you do it in a cell, and then you reconstruct the picture dot for dot, and the signals we found are also diffraction limited and blurred. But if you do it point by point, you know that every point is a single dot, and the resolution is only dependent on the number of photons and not the limits of the optics. And that's why the resolution is increased substantially. If you want to do more colors, there are some problems. So we stay in France with the colors. So chromatic aberration causes this blur. And if you use a white light, and from red, white, blue, it's smeared, and it's chromatic aberration. And normally you have to correct that with registration, and you take the two pictures and try to make them match, but such a registration is never perfect, and there are bound to be errors. In my PhD thesis, I developed a technique that is spectral D-Storm, and we make color from raw data, and you can look at the software, how the software works. Raw data are great. And here's some more examples, what it looks like, and we cannot just make two colors, we can also make 3D reconstructions. All this looks a bit pixelized, but we are really at such a high resolution that you can hardly believe it. And that because you hardly believe it, I will give you a little comparison of scale, and so we went down from the beginning. So this little sphere on the right side has a diameter of 150 nanometers, which really isn't a lot, and such a cent coin has 15 millimeters diameter. And if we imagine that one of these vesicles is a pinhead of 3 millimeters, then for comparison, the centipiece would be 300 meters or three soccer fields. So to remember the picture from the beginning, these pinheads or vesicles are these little green dots that you can see on the normal fluorescence microscopy. So we are really, really well into it, getting stuff out of the data. So it's probably a good idea to build your own microscope, because such as spectral demixing D-Storm, there was nothing like that. So here's a time-lapse how we built our microscope. So we just move it into another room. And some people say, especially in sciences and life sciences, do it yourself, DIY bio. No, you don't do that. Don't you have enough money? So you can just order one. And I say, tinkering is science. And science is tinkering. And that's part of it. Otherwise, there's no progress. Otherwise, we wouldn't have this wonderful technology. Many of these things were developed in 2006 to 2008 because there were some crazy physicists who teamed up with biologists and thought, how can we increase resolution? I don't understand that. Everyone who thinks that should think about it and listen to me for some more. And this building this microscope works because there is open software, and it's Micromanager based on ImageJ. And ImageJ is used by biologists for image processing, but Micromanager is wonderful. And the modern microscopes can be controlled by that. Our STD Storm can control all our different microscopes that we have. They were detected, and anyone has a new device without a driver, he just writes a driver, puts it into Micromanager community, and everyone can use it. It's wonderful. And what's also cool is this picture here. This is a picture from my 12 euro microscope, which I have here. So the software which can control the most advanced microscopes can also control this 12 euro microscope, which you have from online order. And Arduino also works if you build your own microscope table. So look at this, it works. So some people thought, hey, building ourselves, wonderful. There's a blueprint for cost-effective do-it-yourself microscopy. So such microscopes like these you can buy for 800,000 microscopes and can do two colors and 25 nanometers resolution. But you can build it for 20,000 euros with two colors, 40 nanometers, and it's important that we do these, think about these things, because our universities say we can offer to students things from research. But what that means for third world countries where there's a university who wants to research, I don't think I have to emphasize it anymore if you look at the numbers. The same is for SIM, as FairSIM. I talked about it before. FastSIM is an idea how to do structured illumination microscopes cheaply. And if you look at the commercial offer, it's about a million for a commercial SIM microscope, can do four colors, needs 10 minutes for the image reconstruction. Or you just use the open free software and buy the parts with not quite as beautiful, really neat surfaces, but a lot cheaper, 25 kilo euros, three colors and 30 milliseconds with FairSIM. And it's just wonderful.
Der Applaus für alle Leute, die in diesem Gebiet arbeiten. Also
so that was really
gerne weiter. Ich treffe die auch.
The applause for all the people who work in this field, and I'll meet them again in 2 or 3 weeks. Maybe they're watching. Hi.
So, warum spielen so wenige mit Mikroskopen?
So, why do so few people play with microscopes if you're working in the life sciences,
who
do research, first and foremost, think about their experiment and the cell and the little bit of life that they have, and so making all the experiments with it, and that's, you have a head full with all the things, and sometimes you have completely different ideas, so stick a banana in your head, or something silly. All this works a bit slower. So thinking about open data, open source, and making the software available, but more and more I realize that it really can't work differently. And what I want to tell you is it's not so much about pictures, but about data. And it's about making everything open and accessible, and we need good people who can write better software, as I can do. I'm just a physicist, so programming is just, well, just with a hammer, and it's just a sculpture, although it should be a painting, but it's a stupid comparison. So there's the conclusion. I talked about the deflection barrier and how it makes problems. So I talked about better computers, better software culture, modern cameras, and all in all, better technology, so we can have super resolution, such as SIM and D-Storm, and that we can make cheap DIY things, but it's mostly about data. So microscopy is data collection and not necessarily making pictures. So raw data are great. So I hope you remember that. And we scientists are a bit slow. So many people have opened their software and published on the open access and published data in the internet. And it has to be more, so be patient with us. But it'll be more and more open science, and everyone can play. And I invite everyone who has love for image reconstruction and programming. And so look at the things I told you about today, and maybe have other cool ideas that we didn't have in our labs. So, and so, I say thank you very much for listening. I'll be in the assemblies, hacking and communications, near the Sendezentrum, by the wardrobe.
And
yes, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the extra applause for Open Science. We have time for about 4 questions. Signal Angel, is there something from the internet? Unfortunately, no. Here are the microphones. I will start with you. Question. You can start immediately with your question, but I want to say something. I have MicroRacher running here on this crappy 12 euro microscope I put here, Ascent, and even with a 12 euro microscope you can see the magnification here. It's pretty impressive though. Then was the star there, you can see this, the edge of the star.
Ja, Software, die teure Mikroskope treibt, kann auch
12 euro treiben, also guckt euch Software which runs very okay. That about the question,
simple Frage,
the easy question.
Du hast gesagt, dass you said
you made several pictures and then you put them together and then you have the whole picture. So what is happening when the things are starting to move on the microscope? Answer. That's an important question. If you want to look at dynamics and biology, you have to be very fast. Using SIM, I said in the beginning, if you want to high resolution, you have way different problems. If you have the structured illumination, you have 15 pictures, 5 pictures, rotation, movement, rotation. If you manage to take these 15 pictures fast enough, let's say in 20 milliseconds, and you have enough emission,
wenn man das schnell rekonstruieren kann,
if you have a fast reconstruction, you have the possibility to observe these dynamics in biology. If you have to take 20,000 pictures, then I won't be able to observe very fast processes. But with modern CMOS cameras, you have the first approaches of this localization microscopy. In one burst, you take 10,000 pictures, reconstruct them, and then in per second, you have like 4 pictures. Then you have high-resolution microscopy. That's a start for slow dynamics. In principle, all these microscopy techniques, such as localization microscopy, you exchange resolution with time. So what you see in space, you lose in measuring time. So for one of these two color images, it takes you about 10 minutes.
Okay.
Ja, ich habe eine Frage. Wie willst du denn bei selbstgebauten Mikroskopen Reproduzierbarkeit von Ergebnissen machen?
If you use self-built microscopes, how are the data reproducible? Question answer?
Eigentlich ist es so, selbst die kommerziell gebauten,
in fact, even the commercial built microscope is not like a standard.
Wenn ich da beim selbstgebauten, okay, das hat
in my self-constructed, so the two numbers maybe 3.
Ja, du hast Optiken, die sind schon in stärkerem Maße standardisiert,
ja, okay,
als wenn du irgendwas selber zusammenklickst.
The person asking adds there are more standardized optics and answer.
Sachen, die ich da vorgestellt habe, immer noch so im 20.000 Euro Bereich liegen.
By the things I just showed you, still in 20.000 Euros part, you still need a good objective and you have to use a standard objective. And that's the point.
Womit es steht und fällt.
That's the point where it stands and falls. And camera, and all the optics.
Da benutzt man auch die, sagen wir mal, die normalen
standardized material.
Erstmal, wenn man ein Mikroskop gebaut hat,
and once you've built this microscope, you have to characterize, you have to test measurements. And then it works, then it's reproducible. But still, they're delivering very, very good results. Oh. And they think, but still, it looks like. Looks like a real microscope, but yeah, it is a real microscope. You must be afraid to build your things yourself. You have to do good test measurements, then you have reproducible measurements. But the same for commercial measurements. You have to prove they're stable, and otherwise,
Beantwortet das deine Frage?
Hier vorne im Blau?
Question?
Genau, es gibt da verschiedene Techniken, die schon
there are different types of techniques, such as conversion microscopes, to go through this limits, for example, using different wavelengths. Was this in fact a green or was it colored? And are there other approaches using maybe UV or XUV or maybe emulsion microscopy? So it can beyond this diffraction limits. I don't know where this 150 nanometers is coming from. So is it going into this direction? Answer. Wavelength is not really helping. In conventional way, this is not very helpful. If you want to tune a wavelength to get a better resolution, why would you want to do this? So you're not losing time.
Also, weil ich mir Leben angucken will.
So you want to observe life forms. If you go into your hard UV and you look at living cells, it's only a very short time you can do this. If you have a cell which is able to move fast enough, it will move away if it's able to. You can hunt them, basically.
Hey, wir müssen auch mal Spaß im Labor.
We also have to have fun in the lab, okay?
Wir sind... Also, Wellenlängen,
so wavelengths, it's not very helpful. At SIM, maybe a little bit. You maybe use 405 nanometers, that's best resolution, where you can change the grid. But you can't go into UV. In standard microscopy, there are also other approaches, such as convolution or confocal microscopes.
paar Sachen rausrechnet.
Where you can just take out and calculate something else. But if you really want to go to this resolution of 150 nanometers,
wenn man da genau hinguckt, dann kann man auch sehen, das Ding
ist hohl innen. You can still see a structure, see it's empty. There are still structures smaller, which you can see. And we use red light.
Wir haben das mit
643 nanometers.
Of wavelength. Also, da ist die Wellenlänge gar nicht so wichtig.
So the wavelength is not that important. The point is, as many photons as possible have to come out. That's what gives our resolution.
Okay, letzte Frage
aus last dem question Internet. From Internet.
Question? Das Internet hat die Frage nach der Größe, die so ein Mikroskop für 25
the Internet asks, what's the size of such a microscope?
Wie verhalten sich denn so and Größe und Komplexität zwischen den kommerziellen
und dem Selbstbau? What are the relations between size and complexity of such a microscope in self-building?
Answer? Das sind so zwei Seiten einer Medaille. Wenn ich ein kommerzielles Mikroskop stehen habe,
if you have a commercial microscope,
die dürfen so ein Mikroskop gar nicht verkaufen.
They're not allowed to sell it.
Wenn du theoretisch in der Lage bist, durch die Okulare durchzugucken
able to look into this ocular and you can switch on these lasers.
Macht total Sinn, dass man das nicht darf.
It makes sense that you're not allowed to do this. Because otherwise, you only have two eyes and you're about to get lasers into them.
Man macht dann auch die Geräte etwas größer, weil die Temperatur stabil sein soll.
Thing is bigger because it should be stable in temperature. Soll,
ja. Beziehungsweise man möchte in der Fertigung auch immer die
and in the end, you want to have the standardized boxes.
Bei Eigenbaumikroskopen
in your own bars, microscopes, you have the big advantage. Why do I need oculars? I just want to do high resolution. I don't want to look through them. So my animation is perfectly aligned with my camera. I'm just looking at the monitor and laser safety is perfect because I simply am not tempted to look into this, so I just see it on the camera. So the philosophy of how to do this is just completely different. You can get a point in the middle, but the point you really save money is this big boxes, heavy things, stable status, where we have various possibilities to say something. You can put in a filter, you can solve them, the software knows what it's doing, you can click something. In a self-built setup, you have to screw a little bit and then you have to put this in there and you have to look, is everything still set? Or it may be a little bit annoying, it is not that nice and user-friendly, but still there's a solution.
Ist in diesen hohen Kosten auch
in its high costs, you have also maintenance
and so ein support, whatever. Und natürlich hat man da eine Garantie, die man beim Selbstbau nicht hat.
So you have a guarantee definitiv. Which you don't have on your own building.
Ändert nichts an dem horrenden Preisunterschied.
It doesn't change anything on the price.
Okay, ganz vielen Dank, André.
Okay, thanks again. Everyone who's interested in physics can stay here. There's a talk about CERN afterwards in Hall 1. So let's thank the speaker again. And we are thanking you for listening to your translation. This has been Pink Dispatcher and Frau Blauwal. Please give us feedback.